Welcome back, everybody. I'm really excited to welcome Shawnda Wilson as our first featured reader tonight. Recently, a friend of mine who brings another friend, her friend said, Shawnda is my favorite poet at Planet Earth Poetry on the Open Mic. So that's pretty awesome because we have some amazing poets on the open mic, as you just saw. So Shawnda is a visual artist, a poet, and a fiction writer, and she received the Mary Garland Coleman Award for Lyric Poetry and the Bill Juby Award, and was longlisted for the Bridge Prize and received second prize in Quagmire Magazine. Her work has been published in magazines and chapbooks since 2001. And Shawnda's new collection, a new chapbook, is called Nous. Is that how I pronounce it, Shawnda? The New. And is in three parts. And new in Greek means mind or intellect. And in philosophy, the faculty of intellectual apprehension and of intuitive thought. And used in the narrower sense, it is distinguished from discursive thought and applies to the apprehension of eternal, intelligible substances and first principles. So I'd like to welcome Shawnda. Please put your hands together for Shawnda Wilson.
Oh yeah, look, it's perfect. Are there Zoom people? Hi, Zoom people.
Yes, Zoom people.
Hi, Zoom people. Hi, people. Okay, so yeah, I just wrote a little something to tell you about the so the chapbook. I'm reading to you from this new collection, which is called The New, and we chose this title because it has a few different meanings that encompass the work within and why the work exists. So new in French means us or we or ours. In French speaking places where I've lived, people always call where they live chez nous. Even if they live alone or the residence is temporary, they call it our place. And even if the intention is subconscious, it is meant to express welcome. In Latin, the new describes the intellect in its highest sense, the intellect before superimposed ideals, intellect before prejudice or judgment. And then the Greeks explain it similarly with one great difference. In the Greeks, they believe it is intellect before the existence of God, which I think is like, it connects us all. You know? So this chapbook has three parts. Part one is untitled, part two is titled For My Father. I will read you one from this section, and then the third part is mainly one long poem that is in nine parts. There's a finishing poem after it. And it's a love letter to New Orleans, the place that I called home for 10 years and still call home. And it's also an homage to all the writers who have memorialized New York City as a city that contains the whole world, which is also a small nod to Montreal back in the day when it used to be the same sort of city. And I will read you part four and part nine of this long poem titled The Neighborhood.
Can you put the mic down in her presence?
How's that? Okay. Okay, great. I might have to turn from it. I'll do that. Okay, so this is from the For My Father section. Cabo San Lucas. I like your wife. The man's English is heavily accented. Wife is drawn out. The two of them chose this restaurant for the aromas wafting down the cobbled street. They approach the podium behind which stands their host, a thick brown man, short with bristled black hair, bursting out across his chest, along his bare arms. As they get close, they notice a mariachi band making rounds and a man selling long-stemmed roses to the diners. "She's my daughter," the man replies. "I like your daughter," the host says. His mouth is leering, crooked. Saliva has formed at its corners. The father shakes his head. Not because the man is being lecherous, but because the father finds his daughter repulsive. The daughter laughs, nudges her father's warm, also brown, fur-covered arm. "Oh, Daddy, I'm used to it. Every man with a working you-know-what wants to stick it everywhere they can." The father steps to one side, steps away from his daughter. His face reads awe, perhaps. Not about how it must feel to be a young woman, men always trolling, but because he finds his daughter repulsive. They order a table full of food, too much food and even more wine. It's easier for them to get along when their mouths are full. The daughter orders tequila. Her father frowns. "I'm going out on the strip after dinner," she tells them. Her father gulps red wine, orders a rum and coke. "Make it a double," he says. Then, "Well, be careful." The daughter throws back her head with a clipped laugh, drinks down her wine, refills the glass, waits for the tequila. The daughter looks at her fat brown father. His hair has gone white. He's talking, but she's not listening. She's thinking about the bars and the parties and sleeping on the beach. She didn't come to Cabo San Lucas to make friends with her father. She came because father's girlfriend left him right before the trip, and this daughter is always up for a free vacation. Okay, and so then this is total switch gear. So this is part four of the neighborhood poem. So we're a ways into it. Fedoras and pinstripe vests on naked waists, handmade mini skirts with pockets sewn on for everything. Brown, kinky hair or tight weaves, eggs pickled brown with onion skin. Bright red pickled pig's tongue, impossible to ignore in 1 gallon glass jars on every cash counter at every corner store. Colorful plastic beads hang in doorways in trees, purple beads and red ones, blue and speckled brown ones. They used to be made of glass when this place was Sin City, not the city that Care forgot, before we imported everything from China. We pretend we don't see the nooses. Miniature party hats with lace and sequins, colored feathers, festoon vest pockets, stuck in oily hat bands. Even the babies wear ribbons in their hair, tiny pink painted nails. So many babies needed to keep us tethered to this earth. But when looked at closely, the masqueraders look tawdry. Theater thick makeup bubbles threatens to leak the heat. The smiles turn to grimace over clenched teeth. When they have made it to the end of the line, the street sweepers clean the tornado-like aftermath. Beads throw rejects, daiquiri cups tossed unfinished. The queens in cozy corner seats at red velvet bars on brass stools, makeup long forgotten, hanging in clots, making rivers and wrinkles as they laugh. They drink four-finger cocktails to forget there ever was trouble on any horizon. There is a silver man sitting through it all, still as the eye of a hurricane, the silver paint that covers him head to toe. He is older than ancient. He bears witness for Dr. John and Papa Legba. At times, Manon Brigitte sits invisible by his side. They remember when the oak trees were young, the boughs less good to climb on or sit and hide in. Some tourist who will not be visiting again touches this silver man, jostles him, mocks his solidity. They step on his feet, push him harder than friendly, mistake his proud patience for humility. They find no cracks. His soul long ago broken by the dead in the Mississippi, he has borne far worse than drunken taunts. Unperturbed, he keeps bitter peace. Silver Man has the ancestors' hands to prod him on, to keep him from the gutter, to remind him that his old race has been pushed from prior shores to curbstones called home. His mind is sage on the wind, his mind is silver when he wills it, appraising all who pass unobserved with his sleight of mind glance. He is the Libra scale's balance. When it is the blackest of night, fog too thick to see his own hand, he walks to the river, offers everything he's got, lets the water drip from his tired old eyes, the silver paint pays no mind. And then this is the last section, number 9. Life. Coming from my graveyard shift at Bufa's, the daywalkers block my path. As I ride my bicycle to the upper ninth ward against the current, the daylight awake for hours now as I nod out, my head bobbing. A struggle, careening, I pump my legs, my filthy dog-filled bed calls my name. The neighborhood is shuffling, coffee's brewed for mixing whiskey into, the riverboats pass on the Mississippi. One man's hand dangles in the water, warm, communing with the ashes of the many dead sunk there. Life, shocking, befuddling. Calling out commands to be adhered to, it kicks my ass, then holds out its hand to help me back up. Bruised knees buckle, then a deep breath, square shoulders, leaving my ego ruffled and preening itself. The desperate morning eyes of the homeless beseeching beggars and children running screams unfettered. Wind chimes flutter, birds chatter, and the pregnant crack whore outside the red store says, "Akahada, to everyone who crosses her path. Electric currents of life. Crackle inescapably, we are shrouds, influenced by the lights of those who crowd us. We are a part of it, the neighborhood circuit board. Long nights, argued away, in taverns, in speakeasies, outside Hank's, in the parking lot. The strangeness of the pre-morning streets echoes on empty stretches, eeriness creeps. Stumbling drunks toward home from work, life leaks, sweats, will not be defeated. Life, bent, mangled, undulating, fades, then shoves and punches. Like wine in a barrel, feasting on fructose and yeast, binding, becoming new, crawling, dawdling, levering, climbing, humming, flailing, challenging life in the neighborhood.
Thank you, Shawnda. That was incredible. I'm so grateful that you were here tonight. Thank you. Sorry, just noticing something weird. Oh, good. Okay, all good. It's been a night of technical glitches. Ali Blythe is the author of three critically acclaimed poetry collections that explore trans poetics. I have all three of these books, and they are absolutely brilliant, and they really belong in everyone's library. Ali is the winner of the Vallum Award for Poetry, twice finalist for the Dorothy Livesay BC Book Award, and recipient of an honour of distinction from the Writers' Trust of Canada for emerging LGBTQ writers. Blythe's poems and essays are published in national and international literary journals and anthologies, including the Broadview Introduction to Literature, Best Canadian Essays, and Best Canadian Poetry in English. Ali Blythe also held roles as a guest editor for special editions of literary magazines, including the League of Canadian Poets, ARC Magazine, and the Malahat Review, and as editor-in-chief for the Claremont Review, an international literary magazine for youth. Please welcome Ali Blythe.
Okay, I think this is the right place to do this, given all the beautiful long past poets behind us and all the lovely live ones here tonight. I'll start with my table of contents. Bright star, would I were steadfast as thou art. Not in lone splendor, hung aloft the night, and watching with eternal lids apart, like nature's patient, sleepless hermit. The moving waters at their priest-like task of pure ablution round Earth's human shores, or gazing on the new, soft-fallen mask of snow upon the mountains and the moors. No, yet still, steadfast, still unchangeable, pillowed upon my fair love's ripening breast, to feel forever its soft swell and fall, awake forever in a sweet unrest. Still, still, to hear her tender taken breath, and so live ever, or else swoon to death. Okay, Keats is in the room. We're all in the room. Keats being one of the muses for this book, Steadfast, my other being my love there, who read earlier. Just such a big thank you for having me here, Kieran and Pep, again, which I've read every single time that I've had a book at Pep, and it's just such a gorgeous through line, and to have you all here and have friends and loves and new people reading as well. My first book, I'm going to show them just because they're just gorgeous. Julie Scriver at Goose Lane Editions has done them all. Twoism is the first in a trilogy exploring trans poetics. And it really is about trying desperately to put on any body other than one's own. So animals, mass, myths, a lover. And then my second book, Hymn Switch, which is really about trying to dream oneself into one's own body, trying to be in your own body in places of recovery. And then what I'll read from tonight is Steadfast, and I'll show you the table of contents with Keats' poem there, and we'll talk a little bit about that. Because I know there are lots of poets in the room, and I thought you might be interested in the form and what I was up to with Steadfast. So yeah, I'm sure you all probably recognize Keats's poem. About 6 years ago, I was looking for a place of refuge in my life. I was thinking a lot about what refuge is, how we can find it in poetry, what makes a poem a place of refuge for people, what makes it so that we call it back to ourselves when times are hard, when times are good, when we need something to get us through. And that first line just kept coming back to me and back to me. Bright star, would I were steadfast as thou art. It's just such a gorgeous first line. Well, actually, why don't we just start there? I'm gonna read the poems for those ones first, I think. Bright star, here you are, unsteadily shining next to me. After a long and lustrous journey from afar. Okay, little torch, it's time I got to work once more, hitching my constellation of illusions to you. Would I were steadfast. In beloved darkness, surfeited with arrows, I wheel unfixed. Be outside your human smallness, the stars want to tell us. But the night just pours with the same old stories. My little who did what to whom memorial. As thou art. I believe everything you've ever told me. We'll use it all to conceive a nocturne for your childhood violin. In it, someone small tries to compose a self while God listens. So I decided to build a place of refuge in the poem. So I took Keats's poem and I broke it up into 28 parts. And then I wrote my own very much more contemporary love poem into it. And so in that way, tried to write myself into the canon in some way, I suppose, my own small, big love into this greater love's work, and struggle with what romanticism means, what the poetic apostrophe means. So Keats's work is a poetic apostrophe. It's speaking into the at something that can't respond, you know, whether that be a faraway lover, or an idea, or a theme, or an inanimate object. In this case, he's speaking to the star. In my case, this whole book takes place over one night, lying in bed next to a sleeping lover, speaking into the night, speaking to the lover who's asleep and who can't respond. So yeah, let's go to the Volta, which is right at the middle of the poem. No, yet still. During intermission, we are meant to imagine the action carries on without us. Once an act could only go on for the length of a candle. Then an interlude in which all is reset. Relit. We must re-enter so softly on our faux pas de deux. The scene has changed, but two figures continue their delicate revolutions. You know, when Keats wrote this, it's considered his sort of last sonnet, whether it is or it isn't. We can probably never know, but he wrote it a draft of it as he lay dying off the coast of Italy. He couldn't come to shore because there was a quarantine. And he wouldn't be alive much longer. He was very young, 24, 25, I should know. And so he took a book of Shakespeare's sonnets down from the shelf and turned to an empty page next to a lover's complaint, actually, and wrote a draft of this poem in. There are lots of blank pages in this book, so if you were to get it, you could write your own poems into it, and it could just go on and on and on ad infinitum in some way. I actually did a workshop with some kids, students at a university, and it was wonderful. I got them to pick out their own poems to do this method with, which I called the break and enter poem. So they went and picked a poem that meant something to them and then broke it all up. And we actually wrote a poem into it. It was really fantastic. A great thing to do if you have students or people that you workshop poems with. So I'm going to read just a few poems from the end of the book. And we'll skip the Fair Love's Ripening Breasts, and we'll move to Feel Forever. Every night, a minor festival of making ourselves known. A slow landscape, our stolen home, where the hills are set about like pillows. The dog is a system of silence when he moves to my hand to ask if it's yet morning. The cat keeping warm between us, full of sparrow. First choruses from the willow, its lashes still loaded with mascara. I am in a good place. The thought tumbles from a higher blossom onto a similar blossom. A black dress slipped down, a star's proof in its wavering. We keep practicing the broken onto of dawn, trembling in ardent spring flowers on one mountain instead of two. It's soft fall and swell. Each new day is cut from the key of the last, microscopically changed and changed, so the door that flings open is never the same door at all. I will erase even this, try to remember it better, write it out again, and so on down the page of us. If I must believe in something, I choose eternal repetition. I'm slipping you the key to the infamous hotel with its long hallway of choosing you. Awake forever. I moonlight as a ghostwriter who responds to burned or buried letters. They all seem to begin, yours ever, I wish you'd go back to writing me love poems. To which, you romantic, I must once again reply, just what on earth do you think I'm doing here? It was once said that to write any love poem, you must first invent the poet who will write it. There is no return post from ashes or dust. But don't worry, I am nearly there. In a sweet unrest. All this wasted brilliance we lie within, surrenderish, prone, in a midlife that finds us so uncomposed, enjoying companionship with a faraway fear. Just two animals making their possibilities known. still, still. Being in love is a lake. The world turns upside down. We shatter it when we dive in. How dark it had to become. To see the unnumbered sparks on each shook swell. To feel their gold hooks fixed in us. To hear her tender taken breath. My better angels sing to me if I don't move too much. But I am only what comes instinctively. I, the body, the instrument, the baton, the bow. The quiet note of your accompaniment librates air. And so live ever. For one moment, we're held, just so, by a hand that knows us best. As though we're silk stems or a hare's ears in the soft grip of suspense before we are lifted from the magician's hat. And then just the penultimate erotic swoon here before the to death, which I'll leave you to read if you'd like at the table back there. The whole night's passed. Everything's gathered sort of into this last movement when dawn breaks. Or else swoon. A winter dawn. We swan in the follow spot of our fabled stage. A man with a bow and arrow pursues a wedge of swans to a lake of tears and finds refuge, unfledged. Or he steals a swan's coat and marries her telluric nakedness. Or he's swan-drawn, driving a heavenly chariot, losing control of time. Or he throws down the bow between the lines of his indecision and receives furious oration from the charioteer, who drove him into an impossible position. There are no swans in that one. Just divine self-revelation between best friends. In one, you play the young man cured of his love for another young man. I play the other young man who, enraged, drowns. Will you sing and dive where I fell to you? The gods will so enjoy your sad songs, they'll transform you into a heavenly swan. In another, you play the black swan, and you play the white swan, and I play the prince who chooses wrong. To break the spell, he must pledge his love. I hope he breaks his weapon and does. Or let us both play Nijinsky and just keep lifting the form with our queerness. It's a lake. Or a city, a battlefield, the sky, ancient fiction, it's just a stage. In every story, the appetent hand takes hold, and in apotheosis of love, we drown or ascend, or die best friends by each other's side. In our emerital bed, a cloud of feathers is gathering at our thighs, our fingers, we open our mouths, and I swear I don't make these things up. Clouds, tipped gold or lead, one arrow is blooming in. Toward one myth, dissolving within another, risking our own nihility. Thank you.